Live, local, breaking news. This is WYFF News 4 at 6 in high definition.
A woman lost her life after this accident on I-85, but she did not die from the collision. What happened to her is a warning to us all. Good evening. Welcome. I'm Michael Cogdor.
And I'm Carol Goldsmith. Troopers say she had gotten out of her car to see if the man who hit her was okay. She was then hit by a passing vehicle.
News 4's Mike McCormick is live and local on the story. He is in our Spartanburg newsroom tonight. Mike, the Highway Patrol wants all of us to take something away from this, right?
Yeah, that's right, Michael and Carol. Troopers say that you should stay inside your vehicle after an accident. And if you have to get out, stay as far away from the road as possible.
Eno's a really good person.
Marina Mikaluk fought back tears to tell us about her cousin, Ina Malamura.
We grew up together. We're related. Our mothers are twins, so everything we did together.
She says her 20-year-old cousin was known for being a giving person.
She liked to minister to people. We went on a mission trip together, and she had a big heart. She would give her last to people.
Proof of that came Wednesday morning on I-85.
She will be greatly missed.
Officials say Malamura was heading home from work around 6:20. She slowed down because of debris in the road. Troopers say that's when Cayetano Hernandez rear-ended her, causing her to spin around and come to a stop in the median. Officials say Malamura got out of her car to check on Hernandez, and while doing that, she stepped into the interstate and got hit by a passing car. Troopers charged Hernandez for not having a South Carolina driver's license and for following too closely.
We have a lot of relatives, most everybody, family lives in Virginia, and everyone's going to come down for the funeral and just give her the respect she deserves because we don't know how we're going to be without her.
Mikaluk says her cousin always focused on the future.
She always dreamed big. She had dreams of the impossible. I always told her, Ina, that's not possible, but she always put higher goals than everybody else, and I'm sure she would have gotten there if she were living today.
Dreams and a bond broken.
I love her dearly.
When selflessness led to a life lost.
I just want to thank everybody for everything and for all the friends and family that are coming out. We greatly appreciate it. Just keep us in your prayers and the family especially, and God bless everybody.
And the man who troopers say hit Malamura suffered minor injuries. Mike McCormick, WYFF News 4, live tonight in the Spartanburg newsroom.
Mike, thank you. The family of a Wofford College student who died last year has filed a lawsuit against the college. They claim the sophomore's death could have been prevented. Our report tonight from News 4's Nigel Robertson.
This is the 911 call.
I have a sick student. He's passed out, and I need him here now.
Is he is he breathing?
He's unconscious right now, ma'am.
Is he breathing or not?
He is breathing, ma'am, but like I said, he's very pale.
Late on September 9th, 2011, 20-year-old Randall Heffron, a Wofford student, was eating pizza with friends in a dorm room when his airway became blocked. Heffron died. Now his family has filed a lawsuit claiming that Wofford and two campus safety officers are responsible for his death.
The 911 call is significant because the officer had to leave the body in distress to make it. He had to go outside of ship dormitory. And I don't know if you've been in ship dormitory, but it's not just walking out in the hallway and out the door. So he had time. He had to get outside, and he left the body. He left the body with other students who had been out with Randall that day as well. That's the significant part of the 911 call.
Nigel Robertson, WYFF News 4, Spartanburg.
Now, it's also very important to note here that Heffron had a blood alcohol level more than 3 times the legal limit. Wofford College had no comment today. The student's family has yet to say if they'll seek any financial damages.
Quicker and less costly access to medical care. That's the goal as two upstate health care systems talk about starting a partnership. News 4's Myra Ruiz joins us with more. Myra.
Well, today, Carol, the Lawrence County Healthcare System announced that it's in exclusive partnership negotiations with the Greenville Hospital System. As the medical staff tended to patients in the hospital, administrators discussed ways to make the Lawrence County Healthcare System healthier by partnering with the Greenville Hospital System.
A partner with GHS could offer Lawrence County residents enhanced services while providing services not currently available.
There's a bigger dependence for subspecialty care, so it's very important that we have connections so that we can streamline care, initiate care, and do what we need to for the patient here.
Lawrence County has already taken its own steps to deliver care more efficiently.
Clinical integration is about working with your medical staff and medical community to deliver consistent, efficient care across the continuum of care.
Administrators say partnering with GHS would strengthen negotiating power with insurers and buying power for the whole system, and there are other considerations.
We'll be discussing governance. We'll be discussing the kinds of investments in Lawrence County that the Greenville Hospital System intends to make.
We both believe there's a better way to care and serve our patients and their families, and we lead with that. So this is what this is about for us.
The negotiation process is expected to last several months, and both health system boards will vote on a final decision. Michael?
Thanks, Myra. Deputies tell us they know who they're looking for in that Waffle House shooting in Anderson County from earlier this month. Here's a surveillance photo of the robbery for you. This happened on September 17th at the restaurant on the Highway 28 bypass. Anderson County deputies say the man you see there fired a shotgun toward the bathroom area during the holdup. The Sheriff's Office gang unit is looking for two people in connection with this crime tonight. They say they have warrants right now on 20-year-old Zedrick Ramsey and 30-year-old Carlos Antonio Scott. If you know where to find either of these men, call Crime Stoppers right away. You don't have to give your name there at 23 Crime. Deputies tell us, by the way, that Scott is free on bond for a home invasion and kidnapping case that happened back on August 9th of last year. Deputies consider both those men to be armed and dangerous.
Deputies are looking for a man they consider to be armed and dangerous as well. 44-year-old Mark Christopher Oliver is wanted by the Anderson County Sheriff's Office. He was last seen in the area of James Cox Road in Belton. Deputies say he pulled a gun on a woman and fired a shot in a mobile home on Longshore Drive. They say he then took off into the woods. No one was hurt in this incident. If you know where Oliver is, call Crime Stoppers 1-888-CRIME-SC.
The man suspected in this case, violently attacking a store clerk in May, is in more trouble tonight. The police chief there in Lawrence County says he's charged with murder in a different case. First, here's the surveillance video from the Little Cricket store on Church Street in Lawrence. In this case, Richard Evans stands accused of putting a knife to the clerk's throat and stealing cash. The clerk survived all that. Well, now Evans is accused of attacking 81-year-old Willis Blakely Jr. at his home in April. Authorities say he also stole the man's car. The police chief says Mr. Blakely ended up going door to door, knocking, looking for help. He was later found on a porch, bleeding from his head, and he soon died. Evans is in the Lawrence County Jail tonight, and the chief says Evans committed a similar murder in the late 90s in the same neighborhood. We're told he served 18 years and had gotten out of prison a few months before attacking Willis Blakely.
A second person is in custody in connection with a shooting at a party. Deputies arrested John Earl Bates Jr. late yesterday afternoon. He is charged with discharging a firearm into a building and common law riot. Last week, Janoris Alexander Trayman Lartman was charged with attempted murder. The two are accused of a shooting that happened at a party in a VFW on Old Whitmire Highway earlier this month.
Somebody broke into an adult novelty store and made off with thousands of dollars worth of merchandise. Greenville County deputies say it happened sometime but during the night between Monday and Tuesday. They say a passerby called saying the front door of Forbidden Fruit on North Main Street in Greer had been shattered. The store owner reports more than $28,000 worth of product is missing. If you have any information that may help solve this case, again, call Crime Stoppers. The number is 23-CRIME. Tonight, authorities continue the search for a registered sex offender and a missing 12-year-old girl who is believed to be with him.
An Amber Alert was issued from North Carolina for 12-year-old Abigail Faith LaFevers. She's from Carteret County. She's 5'4", weighs 90 pounds, has brown hair and brown eyes. She was last seen wearing black Nikes and carrying a pink book bag with peace signs on it. Authorities believe she was taken by this man, 38-year-old Timothy Howard Newman. He is a registered sex offender. He's 5'8", 210. He has brown hair and brown eyes. Investigators say the two may be in a car like this one. It's a red 98 Chrysler Sebring. The license tag number is AKT6534. Authorities say the Amber Alert has been extended to all southern states. They believe the two may be headed to Florida. If you see them, call 911 immediately.
A former upstate judge pleaded guilty to pocketing money from false tax claims. 48-year-old Janet Reese was a judge in Central. She also owns a tax business. And prosecutors say Reese filed multiple returns in the 2008 tax year, claiming tax credits for first-time home buyers. But officials say the clients had not bought homes. They say Reese had an estimated $360,000 in refunds deposited into an account she controlled. She'll be sentenced at a later date. She faces up to 5 years in prison and $250,000 in fines. Okay, if you're eating pork right now, don't panic, but analysts predict pork prices will rise, plenty, in the not-too-distant future.
And along with bacon, barbecue lovers should start bracing for higher prices at their favorite restaurants. News 4's Angela Rodriguez has more on how soon all of that could happen.
If there was an official state food in South Carolina, it would probably look like this.
That's a pork butt I've just got going.
Barbecue isn't just a meal. For many Southerners, it's a way of life.
Can't live without it.
But there is a major issue facing the pork industry as a whole, right down to your table. A shortage of corn nationwide means hog food is more expensive. And that means farmers can't feed pigs. So they're selling them now, a lot of them.
Prices of meats are actually dropping now. And then beginning of next year, that's when they're going to start skyrocketing.
And that is putting some real heat on restaurants that make a living out of pig picking. In his 20 years at Henry's Smokehouse, Tiger O'Rourke has never seen supply and demand like this.
It really does make us nervous. We try to keep our prices low.
The reality is, menu prices could increase sometime between February and March. But one thing is for certain, the recipe isn't changing.
Probably still going to eat it, though. You know, what are you going to do? Prices go up, you still have to eat.
And the flavor's here to stay. Angela Rodriguez, WYFF News 4.
And Henry's Smokehouse tells us they are taking a wait-and-see approach for the time being.
Now your live Super Doppler 4 HD weather forecast.
Get a load of this gorgeous view of the Great Smoky Mountains. This was taken today by Ben Phillips from Anderson. He was somewhere on Highway 19 in North Carolina between Cherokee and Gatlinburg. You can kind of see some yellows popping up in those leaves. I think in a couple of weeks we'll probably start to see a little bit more color fill in there. But all in all, a gorgeous day to be in our mountains of western North Carolina. Right now in Asheville, it is 77 degrees. We've got mostly sunny skies. Humidity is still pretty low. Winds out of the south-southeast at 6 miles per hour. In Greenville, good evening to you. 80 degrees, mostly sunny skies. A southerly wind at 6 miles per hour. 80 for you in Spartanburg and in Anderson. 80 degrees as well with calm winds. Temperatures across the rest of the western Carolinas and northeast Georgia in the 70s and 80s. It's currently 81 in Clemson, 83 degrees in Abbeville, 81 in Greenwood, 80 in Toccoa. We've got 77s from Franklin through Andrews, a cooler 73 in Hendersonville. Dew points are starting to creep up. Our humidity each day has been rising. When we started on Monday, we were in the 30s and 40s. Today, the 50s and 60s. And to put things in perspective, when we see these numbers in the 70s, that's that oppressive humidity that we feel during the summertime. Live Super Doppler 4HD, it shows no rain to talk about this evening, and we are going to stay dry through Thursday, all thanks to high pressure that is sitting over us. But you can see these showers stretching from the northeast all the way through the southern plains. In fact, we've got thunderstorm watch boxes up and running for Oklahoma. Some of this energy eventually is going to sag south into our neck of the woods come Saturday. That's when we'll start to see that precipitation increase. But until then, again, high pressure sitting over us, so we will stay dry. This westerly flow is going to keep our temperatures about 5 to 10 degrees warmer than normal for this time of year, and that's the story as we make our way through Thursday. But come Friday, high pressure starts to weaken, and this front starts to get a little bit closer to us. As it does, our cloud cover increases, and this is where we will start to see that slight chance of a shower or storm in the forecast, mainly for the mountains of North Carolina. So your forecast for Thursday, the second happiest day of the work week, plenty of sunshine in the upstate, light winds, warm temperature of 85 degrees by 3 o'clock. In the mountains, pretty much the same conditions, although we will warm up at 3 o'clock to 81 degrees. So on Friday, yes, we're still mostly dry. We do have that slight chance of a shower in the mountains for Friday afternoon and Friday evening. Then that front starts to get closer to us for the weekend. So if you had outdoor plans, looks like the afternoon and evening, we'll see off and on isolated to scattered showers and storms. The same as we make our way into back to work Monday. And you can see those temperatures are going to start to cool back down in the upstate to the 70s for those highs, and in the mountains the low 70s, but that's a little closer to normal as opposed to 85 for Thursday. That's not normal.
That's an outlier. Yeah. Right.
Thanks,
Kim. Thanks.